Good evening, and I'd like to call the December meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to order. And we'll begin our meeting this evening by first reviewing the minutes of our previous meeting on November 17th, 1998. If any board members have any comments, additions, or clarifications to make on the previous minutes, please bring them to our attention.
All those in favor, raise your hand. The next thing I'd like to do is review correspondence we received rather than past month. We received a letter from Elkhoff regarding the Erickson application. We also received a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding the Erickson application. And we also received a copy of the zoning news from November of 1998. Awaiting us on the podium this evening, which we have received are a series of communications from various people regarding the proposed tower zoning amendments, which will be on the agenda later on in the evening tonight. They're too numerous to all cite subject matter, but I can go through them and put on record the names of people who took the time to communicate with us. But we'll all be digging and reading them, but just getting a few minutes, so we have a chance to do that. So these are all memos and letters regarding the proposed tower zoning ordinance. We have Michael Hill, town attorney, Corey Cool, Edward McCall, Priscilla Armstrong, Penny Parson, John and Ellen Brady, Edward Robinson, M.D., Rita Canty, Elaine Anilos-Zabotny-Swalas, Marco Foley, Charles Mainville, excuse me, Denise Buckowitz, Carol Friedman, Dave Mitchell, Susan Garrett, John Buckowitz, Lisa Hansen, Sue Ellen Pride, Myron Michaels, Dr. Arthur Schleyman, and S.M. Schleyman. Those we will be able to look at, but unfortunately, we're not able to, since they were just on the podium as we came in the door. That being recorded, I'm going to start meeting with a review of old business. The first item being the Sprague Master Subdivision Plan, a request by the Sprague Corporation for final subdivision approval, resource protection permit, and private access way for a 62 lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road. Tonight, we'll be able to hear under section 16-2-4. And to begin, thank you very much. To begin our review this evening, I think it would be a good idea if we had the applicant come to the podium, introduce themselves, and give us an update on status and direction for the issues that we're dealing with, and summarize the application date.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Terry Wan, Lester Barchek, and Yarmouth. And with me tonight is Seth Sprague from Sprague Corporation, John Green, our manager of Sprague Corporation, Lester Berry, is with HM Engineering, Amy Bell Siegel from my office, and myself, here to give you a little bit of an overview of this. This is a public hearing. I don't know how many people in the audience for the public hearing, but we'll assume there are a few people here. We also know that we've been before you now. I think next year we'll go into our third calendar year, at least the third cycle of a chairmanship here. And as the year approaches conclusion, we certainly hope that this process approaches conclusion too, and we certainly would like to try and wrap as much of this up tonight as possible. Those of you who sat before, as in many previous meetings, know a lot about the project. I'd really rather not get into a lengthy discussion of details. I know that after the last meeting, November 17th, when the board deemed our application for final application complete, there was a lot of concern by members of the planning board that the application material, while it seemed very complete, was somewhat overwhelming. It was set a record in our office for number of drawings in one application, and it's hard for any person to get a handle on it. There was a sidewalk several weeks ago. I was not able to make that. I know Amy and Les and Seth and John were there, and I understand it was a very successful walk in terms of being able to review and in some cases re-review issues that had been raised over the last course of discussion that raised by Steve Harding and his review letters. And what we'd like to do tonight is give a very brief overview and then turn over to Les Berry to talk about some of those more detailed issues that have been raised as part of the detailed review. Before I turn it over, I would like to make a few comments, though, about where we stand on a couple of items. First of all, one of the things that we had to do that was talked about last time was to go before the town council for conditional municipal approval of the drainage easement that we talked about before the vote. John Green made a presentation last night and we did get conditional municipal approval from the town council on its score. Les Berry will talk a little more about the DEP stormwater permit. We have been told through last that the permit is that far being issued, that we'll be getting a waiver from the DEP for some of the elements that normally would go into a stormwater permit, and we'll be able to tell you a little more about that, but we can see the end of that tunnel in sight. One of the things we'd like to keep in mind tonight during this discussion, because a lot of what we'll be doing is concentrating with Les's help on some of the details, like gravel grading and pavement and road width and so forth. So keep in mind that this is not a typical subdivision, and I don't want to sound like a broken record, but I think it stands mission at the very beginning that we're doing tonight is looking at a family land use plan for a very large tract of land that has gone through a very detailed, we think, very thoughtful process to arrive at a plan that will go for the next several generations for a family, which has been a long established force in the town. We feel that through the efforts that many people have made, land planners and surveyors, civil engineers, and so forth, have come up with a plan that meets all the criteria that the town has had in terms of dealing with the big picture elements and opportunities for growth in a very responsible way, as well as looking at the micro level details of the project that never barely has to come up for review, things like gravel and the depth of construction and so forth. It is a very lengthy application. We appreciate the opportunity to work not only with Maureen, but also with Steve Harding, most associates. I mentioned last time that the review that he gave us was extremely detailed and pointed. It made our job and Les's job very easy in terms of going down on a point by point basis, looking at how we're going to be dealing with a lot of the issues. Without stealing any of Les's thunder, I'll just say that Les tonight will be going over some of the items that we feel were left either up in the air or needed some clarification and that ultimately resulted in the decision the planning board has to make. Some of the things we feel were pointed out in planning board sidewalk, the things which we'll bring up tonight for planning board discussion. As Wayne said, we are going tonight for final subdivision approval, the alteration permit, and the private access way permit under the various sections of the town ordinance. We have submitted a great deal of information going back to October 30th, and what we'll be doing tonight is reviewing that in as much detail as you'd like to have us reviewing it. With that, I'd like to friendly bring back over to the chair and see if there are any comments on the public hearing.
Thank you very much. At this point in time, I'd like to open the public hearing with regards to the Sprague Master Subdivision Plan. Any interested persons who wish to come share some information or opinion or commentary with the board, we're very interested to hear whatever we can find out, and please just come to the podium and identify yourselves and tell us anything you wish. And with that, I'll open the public hearing. Officially. Would anyone care to come forward? Not everybody come at once. We really are interested in any information or opinions. If you have time to come out, we're more than happy to share any thoughts with us. Seeing no interested members, I'll be coming forward. I'll close the public hearing. And at this point in time, some more specific information regarding the time change comments I think would be entirely appropriate before we begin evaluation.
My name is Les Berry. I'm a BHM engineer on the job, and what I'd like to do is reference a letter written by Steve Harding, Marine, dated November 5th, where he wrote the letter, and he listed, I think it's 23, 24 items, and I wanted to address those issues. Okay, we set up the plans to the town. We also set up a full set of plans, that is a full size set of plans to Steve, and he took time and he went through all 78 sheets, and with color pencil markup, comments, additions, little things here and there. And so we've received that set of plans back from Steve. We met with Steve after back in Sunny Moon in early December, and went over his comments, we went over his letter here, so we have a much clearer idea exactly what he meant, and that's what I want to address at this point. And so item number one is revisions to the plans. At least 78 sheets that we've got, he's got a number of comments, plus some of the few changes we have, and we certainly make those changes. We've gone through Steve and understand exactly what he's looking for, and what we need from the understanding of the board is that once we get through this process, we'll correct all the plans, get them up to date, turn them over to Steve, and let him check it off, and make sure it's okay. And we didn't want final approval to be held up for this, but just hold my level, signing over whatever it's all set, and we think that'll be okay with the board if we just make it that way. Item number two is road signs. What we're proposing in the handout is a couple of existing signs up there. They were green, they had 3-inch lettering, and we thought they were fairly attractive. We asked for a waiver of the actual town standards for signs. We have our own signs up there, and Steve said that he agrees with it, and Bob Malley, his comment was that he agreed as long as there were certain sizes and reflective paint would be on the signs. What we're going to do is we're going to add a detail sheet 5 with specified the reflective paint and the sizing, and you know, and since it's a waiver, we do need board approval, so that was one issue that I guess we're looking for tonight for the board to give some sort of feedback. Is that acceptable group to go, or not? And so I guess if the board would be willing to give feedback directly, we won't take all these at the end at once.
I would recommend the board that you discuss each item as it's brought up and by consensus agree or not agree.
Good morning, members. Feelings about the road sanction proposed? Yes, Al.
This is a private development. I see no problem with the waiver, particularly since it's gone through. And as long as there's like a payment, I don't see a problem.
I concur.
That's why.
Okay. Yes, I think I can tell
that. Stop signs is not a similar type of issue where Steve has agreed with us. What we're going to do is install standard stop signs at all the intersections as agreed to with Public Works Department. In our project, we have a number of places that are obvious stop signs. Like other places where we have a 12-foot drive, two houses. It's, you know, I'm not sure about anything to the area, so it's more, it's almost a deferral decision for the road to install the Public Works Department up there. And if Public Works says, yeah, we want one, we'll open up. And therefore, other places are obvious, we'll open up ourselves. And what we're looking at, like the end of Pomeroy Road here, which we have a T intersection. We have four or five houses coming up there. That'd be obvious, yes, for stop signs. So, okay, trail, two houses up here. You know, we've got open field, and actually, we can see both directions. I don't really think anything necessary there. It's just those are the types of decisions we're looking for. And really, we're just putting it off to four, right? And so, once again, feedback back to the board.
Okay. Any board members have any feelings about basically this will delegate the decision to a sort of decision to Public Works Department in the field? Yes, that's fine.
Okay, thank you. Number four is the pay difference, where we have a number of intersections where we are having a private road intersect with a public road. Steve recommended pay difference, 50-foot long pay difference in all these locations. We understand, you know, what he's saying, and we don't have a problem with what he's saying. Just the applicant believes they have a situation that warrants that each one to look at. First intersection is Ice Pond Road, which is up on Route 77 at that location. We are proposing a 50-foot apron at that particular case. The second place we have private roads coming to public roads is at Pomeroy Road at that location and Tree Line. These will be both new roads onto a public road, and the intersection is what we refer to as rural connector streets. In keeping with the rural character, the applicant requests a waiver for the pay difference at these two locations. We also have existing roads, which would be Fieldways Road, which is at that location, which already exists. Hayfield Road at that location. Lower River Road, which is down here. Monastery Road, Route 77, which is right there. Breakwater Road, right there. These are all existing roads that are not paved at this point in time. The applicant doesn't have any problem upgrading them for the fire chief request for a little wider roads, but to pave them, they're asking once again for the rural character to leave them where they are. And so this is an issue that we just throw them before the board, give us feedback.
Okay. Do any of members have any feelings about these?
Yes. No objection. We have routinely passed a basis requirement for private roads coming out of public roads.
Anybody else have any?
To the traffic flow, has anything been done to determine how many cars are actually, you get some idea of what the traffic flow is on these roads?
I don't know, perhaps, John, you can tell me the traffic count.
Well, not just the current traffic, but assume that the subdivision goes in and these lots are developed. Right. Obviously, there's going to be a tremendous increase.
That's true in some cases. What we have, for example, Breakwater Road here, is an example where we have four lots specifically here, two lots located here. The one family here has three daughters who are currently driving. Those daughters would be the ones that would be having those homes. So at this point in time, the number of vehicles out of that one household is almost equal to what we have maybe two or three of those lots. So what we have internally throughout this plan is a lot of the children of age would be pulling on these lots are already driving. I don't know if we're going to see such an increase that it's going to have any effect. The property is so large that at any given point, the traffic is very minimal. I really didn't sense. Don't know what the question. If you can further refine questions to what you're looking for, as far as paper goes, I don't see where the number of residents per se have any effect on the apron itself. Hayfield entrance, we've had two lateral trucks coming out of that road for the Monastery Road. The construction, 30-40 trucks a day going in and out of there for that project, which was a one-time project. But the apron held up, or the gravel apron, I should say, held up. And if that was going, I can't see what the impact is going to be any greater than something of that nature. You don't have any problem with pavement. You have no snowplow problems, maintenance problems in 15, 16 years I've been there on any of these aprons.
Any other comments by board members regarding the 50-foot aprons of the roads? I have a question about what might be sort of the entrance aprons, if you will, the ones at Monastery and Breakwater. What sort of condition are those maintained in, or do they tend to have gravel up by the travelway, or
in both intersections,
any of them have any amount of traffic on those ones that see?
Okay, those two intersections drain or break back into the project, so gravel doesn't tend to roll out in the street, all tends to stay within it. And on the Breakwater, at this location, we have perhaps six potential new lots that would use Breakwater Road on a routine basis through this area. In the Monastery Road, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, those are all existing. We have maybe six that would be new coming out this way. All the rest of these, I believe, would feed out through the Charles Johnson and Fowler Road entrance out into the mainway, so it's really, you know, half a dozen on each one of those two intersections would be new houses for new traffic.
Thank you.
Okay, question number five has to do with drainage, and there's right, sorry, a minor comment and a major comment here. Minor comment has to do with culvert sizing and not causing any ponding. What he's commenting about on Coop Lane, which is this area, right along the, yes, sir, there was 2 15-inch culverts that tended to have a ponding in addition to what we've been last year. We redid the calculations change from 15 to 18-inch culverts, so that's easy to solve, and that's not an issue we can correct that. The major issue is in the stormwater management report, which turned into the state, since the state has to be approved by the state. We asked for a waiver of detention in all the whole project here, and the state has agreed to that. And the reason for detention, stormwater detention, that is, under the pre-development conditions, which is the existing conditions, we have a certain amount of runoff going off into the gully ditches and under the ocean Skirling River. In post-development condition, we have increased the amount of roads, we have a couple of lots, and there's no logical way to capture that extra runoff, especially when you're wide road by 2 feet. And so we asked for a waiver from the state is granting us this waiver, and we need the town to also grant us this waiver. And so once again, before the board, I can get into more detail on that issue if you want. Steve has recommended the granting a waiver in his letter.
Any board members have any opinions on the stormwater manager? The culverts you mentioned, are you mentioned sizable culverts down near the airstrip, where those leaders are something existing?
Okay,
detention feature.
Yes, this right along Coop Lane, this right along the airstrip, is a ditch that heads parallel to the airstrip. That is going to be enlarged, and in the plans, I think it's 11 A or B, some sheet. There's a large pipe that's going to go across the airstrip along a gravel road and then into the pond, which is all the river was. And so it will still go through the ponds, which is the pond, which is a fire pond, but it's not any additional pond volume, is what it is. But that's a major drainage area or drainage collection point that will go through the pond into the armored ditch area in that section.
Okay. Any problem with that, board members? That's the problem, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Number six, we mentioned culverts, and he's talking about culvert specification. In the general details, we did have a culvert specification, and throughout plans on the length, slope, and a couple of other details, we've gone through that with him, and we've noted all those on the plans, and so that's not really an issue that we need to do on. Just more detail on the plans that we're going to put on to make us see that, and we'll go through that with him. Okay, number seven is easements, and that was the issue about the drainage easement on Fowler Road, which has been taken to council, which I'm not going to take the conditional approval, so that will be added to the plans that will be reported. And number eight is gravel sections, and that issue we discussed with Steve, and I'm not sure how we can answer that one tonight in its entirety. What it is the town standards give a gravel section alternative. We've looked at these gravel sections alternative and created different sections that we believe exceed the town standards. And so we brought that to Steve's attention that we're doing more than what the town is asking for. And he said, okay, I understand. I'd like to get to me in writing so I can review it, have highway people review it, and then you make a recommendation back to the board. So at this point, we have made some proposals with Latin, without Steve's feedback. I don't think you'd be prepared to give a decision whether he's a federal or a state application. I think it's still an issue we've got to skip over for the moment and let some other opinions on my side or not. Okay?
Okay.
Number 9 is Pomeroy Road, and that's the section of road in this particular area. The plans had a 12-foot wide road, which would have been the main access for lots 5, 10, 9, 8, and 7. And Steve recommended a 16-foot wide road to go in that area because he didn't like 12-foot wide road, and we've looked it over and agreed with him. We're going to change to a 16-foot wide road, so that'll be an issue that we'll take care of. Okay, number 10 is Coop Lane, and that's the short connecting between Fieldways Road and Coop Lane. The purpose of Coop Lane was because we would exceed the maximum length of Coop Lane, and it's my understanding when the applicant was here in a workshop that 12 feet was the agreed width that it could be, and they would like to stay with 12 feet. Steve's recommending a wider road in his, because emergency access is not for normal use, it's emergency access, so once again, we'd like to throw this back to the board and say we'd like to keep 12 feet because it's not really a road that anyone's going to travel. It's really just used in a farm work. Now we are operating it, though, 2 12 feet wide and keeping it plowed in winter. So once again, throw that to the board discussion.
Mr. Chairman, yes, did I recall the discussions we had on this, so that was necessary because of the long width down to those lots.
That's right. Yes.
To be a secondary access.
That's correct.
Any other ones? Have you looked at the radiuses where Coop Lane intersects the Skokie Trail just in terms of vehicle access? We know a fire truck can drive down the street. That's 12-foot road, but making the turn on the 12-foot road can be difficult.
Okay, making the turn, with a fire truck, we assume we'd come down Fowler Road, turn on the Fieldways Road, and then it's got a very flat angle turning at that point. Then when it comes around this corner, it's a sweeping curve to cross over the culvert, and then it would have a perpendicular turn right into the, you know, all the lots at this end of the road. I mean, you could round that side of the intersection off with a mortar if it was an issue, but it's, you can drive anyway, so it's an airfield.
Yeah, there is a turn around at the end.
You can round it at that point at the end of the
line. Okay. Any other board members have any opinions on that? That seems adequate to me. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Number 11 is fire pond access. There's two issues on this, and one is Ritchie Packer Pond at this location. And what the plans said is that improved access to dry hydrant. And we took a look at that and said, we do a little better than that. So what we plan to do is change the wording to the existing gravel road beginning at the corner of Skokie Trail, which is at that point right there. The dry hydrant shall be improved to a 12-foot wide gravel road. That was calling it exactly what we want by improved road. And that would be from Skokie Trail down through the past the buildings and the picked up the road down through to that point. And we'd probably turn around down at the end. So once the fire truck down the dry hydrant, turn around together. That would be one issue. And the second issue is Green Pond, which is at this location. And those plans clearly call for a 12-foot gravel access road to the hydrant. In the written comments submitted in 31's cover letter, it said they would be loaned and seeded, and that's not so. Won't be loaned and seeded, we'll leave it as a gravel road. I have a clear that it was going to be gravel. It's still confusing in the cover letter. So we'll leave that as gravel. Those are the two issues at Green Pond access. Okay. And number 12 is the lower river road guardrail. And we did look at the sidewalk, which is at that point right there. And where the turnaround is, and especially this time of the year, once you get up there, you can see there's a pretty good hill over the side there. So we will put in a guardrail in and around the turnaround, a wooden guardrail. That's acceptable. And we'll detail out on plans that can affect the length. Okay, number 13 is a letter of credit, and Seth has been working with town manager going over exactly what he's going to do. Take it. Do you want to talk? Okay, we'll come back to that issue. Number 14 is a wetlands permitting, which Steve is agreeing that the wetlands permitting tax service threshold and the permission to apply for anything for the state. Okay, number 15 is private road area. And what it is in the subdivision plans, take lot 2 for instance. We noticed that lot 2 has a certain area. We have designated an area for each lot and the remaining area, and we didn't designate any particular area for the actual road itself. Steve asked the question, how do I know it all adds up? And so we said, well, we'll just add the area back in and verify that it does add up. And so just a change in just a mathematical check on the plan that we'll add to it and include it as you requested. Okay, number 16 is benchmarks. And what is the area has had flown trouble. There's been a series of benchmarks around the entire site. They're all over the place, spots, and the Spray Corporation has these benchmarks on file in their office. Every time one needs to be used, it can be obtained and used. Steve's saying he agrees with that method as long as they're kept on file. So, once again, I don't think it's a waiver or anything, it's just a method of doing it.
Again, benchmarks are going to be placed in the lots we developed, is that right? Is that the
understanding?
If you're
going to have to build. But you're talking about my mutation, what is that? Okay, that's right. The benchmarks are just an elevation that the contract used to work off from. And we have them all over the site. It's just sometimes they're not on the actual plans or on a remote location. But there's a complete system work evident on this.
Okay, number 17, datum reference.
The datum reference is NGVD, which is National Geographic Vertical Datum, 1988. And 1988 is just a date that we had to add, make sure everyone understands. 1988, all the standard datums used in the state of Maine were updated with a satellite check. And so some of the numbers changed, so we'll just make sure that the numbers on all our plans, and we've gone through them all with Stephen. We add that number, it'll be okay. Number 18 is deed references. We supplied Steve with a list of deed references. There's 40, 50 of them, and which we said we'd like to add to each one of the plans. The town has copied this list. Spray Corporation has a list on filing. And after reviewing it, he's agreed with us that, you know, having it on file would be acceptable. And so I don't think there's any decision on that. Okay, number 19 is monumentation. What we've done is we've taken a plan and we've marked all the existing monumentation on it and all the proposed monumentation on it. We've reviewed it with Steve, and he said he wants a little more, and he pointed out specific spots and this and that. And so what we're going to do is take this plan, give it to Steve with additional monumentation markup on it, and get his approval. I don't think it's an issue that we don't want to
argue with any particular spot. We need one more monument. That's not an issue, I think. We'll just...
Steve, and we asked for a waiver, and Steve said he wants a little more. That's fine. We'll give him, you know, his more. And we... And Steve and I both agree, and I think we'll back to board and say, this is what we want to waive too. I just want to go ready to say that, because we haven't agreed yet. I don't think there's any problem agreeing to explain what he's looking for, and it's reasonable, so there's no problem with that. Okay, phasing, number 20, Ice Pond Road phasing plan. On Ice Pond Road, at this point, we had a turnaround in the proposed driveway for the first phase. Steve didn't want to see that, recommended against it, and so what we're proposing is we're going to put a new temporary turnaround on this side of the road. It's not a driveway, so we'll meet the standards of the town, so we're not going to be asking for any special waiver or any problem there. We'll meet the standard. Okay, 21 is Pond Road, which is a repeat of what we had on the previous time. That's going to be Pond Road, will be 6 feet wide. Okay, number 22, Winters Lane, and in the phasing plan, on sheet 3, note 8, and what we need to add to make it perfectly clear is my permit, by the way, is this location. That's Winters Lane. We're going to add a note to my permit pole for the driveway on Winters Lane for lot 14, which is this lot. The improvements will be made for the design. The improvements are really the turnaround. And so right now there's one lot in that driveway. When the lot for lot 14 is developed, we'll install these turnaround and, at that point. And number 23, Odyssey Lane. And I think, just looking over at the next slide, we see, but I don't think he meant Odyssey Lane, because Odyssey Lane has the correct number. I think he meant Old Fighters Road. Odyssey Lane is down at this point. Old Fighters is at this point. Had the same clarification problem that Winters Lane had. We just had a note permit pole for lot 13, which is that lot right there. All the improvements we made, and the improvements once again to this existing driveway, we can turn around at that point. So, once again, we just meet those. So, out of this whole list, I think really just boils down to, with, you know, your maintaining your favorite rule is working on gravel sections and monumentation. And what we're going to do is work with Steve, come up with a final answer with him, and a recommendation we'll see back and forth. And so, I think that's all we really have on these issues. If there's any questions, we're going to have to answer them.
Any board members have any other questions regarding the technical details of the project?
You might mention this, I missed it. At the very last paragraph in Steve Hardy's letter, there's some additional minor comments and issues, which you can mark on the plans, so have all those things been dealt with as well?
Yeah, those are the plans that Steve gave us back, Mark, that we sat down and met with Steve, we've gone over all those plans, all those changes, and what we're proposing to do is to make those corrections, but since the plans are so massive, what we'd like to do is have one final addition, so when we give it all the comments from everywhere, and we'll deal with those and make changes to them once we got those, if you're final approval, what we should say is hold the mylar, you know, hold final, you know, signing until we've got that, I'll save with Steve, and we'll issue final plans to everybody, it's just a massive set plan, we don't want to get extra copies out there that are not necessary.
Thank you. Okay.
For example, one more thing. On 7-7, the EP came out on the site, and we reviewed the stormwater management report that we needed a permit from them. And they gave us a verbal okay, and that's what we got the permit. It sometimes takes longer for them to actually issue the permit and the review process, so that will be coming on shortly. She had a problem, as I mentioned, granting the waiver of detention. She asked for a maintenance plan for stormwater management facility, so we'll give the town a copy of that. And it's fully written on the Steve's. And then the other issue she mentioned was on Gayfields Road, the lower part, which is pretty much a constant downhill at this point. We have ditches coming down with a culvert discharging the wetlands at that area, and then the culvert going over to the wetlands at that area. She asked if we could have the ditches have what I call turnouts, have a couple turnouts, where the ditches turns out into a hole and just space water into the woods, and so we could do that. That's the only comments we have from state.
At this point in time, we have just a couple of outstanding items that the engineer is currently scheduled to report back to us on everything else we've heard so far. Seems to be well understood. Do you have any further questions?
I have more piece of information, and it's not referred before. I know the morning and heard earlier, December 15th, as we talked a little about the trigger mechanism, so get to the road updates, and I'd like to spend a few minutes talking about this. You guys, of course, that what I present has been already in stage 3 and 4 of your plans. The question, of course, was when will all this work be done? Obviously, with a plan that is planned for the next several generations, all of which is on here, not be done all at once. And the whole concept of triggering needs to be understood in terms of looking at when there is improvements will be done. First of all, what is meant by the improvements? The plan that we have plan talks about the very specific things that will be done in each of the new roads and upgrades to existing roads. The engineering plan, instead of 78 drawings before you, have the engineering specifications, the details, to talk about everything from road widening, pavement improvements, to drainage ditches, to turnout improvements, and so forth. As you know, in dealing with the request from the fire chief, we incorporated a number of pull-offs throughout all the roads. Some places we've relocated hydrants or added hydrants. These are all part of the improvement plans. One of those occur, I'd like to think of three separate triggering mechanisms. The first of course has to do with construction of ice on road on lot 2. This really is in the end of itself, 6 lots that are out there, will trigger the construction of ice on road in one of two variations. As last mentioned, there's a need for emergency temporary turnaround at the beginning of the left, you drive in. Now we constructed if one of lots 1, 2, or 3 be constructed plus a very short segment of ice on road. If lots 4, 5, or 6 were constructed, the entire length of road would be built without that emergency turnaround, but will include the turnout at the end between lots 2 and 4, between lots 4 and 2, 5. So that really has to stand by itself, such understanding. One of the points of discussion about all this, of course, has been the need for an emergency through road system throughout the development, throughout the property, rather. And that gets really the issue of how does those improvements get triggered by development of lots around here. The note on the right-hand side on sheet 3 summarizes how those occur. In addition to the work we done on ice on road, and keeping that separate, we are considering two other major triggering events. The events will be occurs to trigger the work on the north and west through road, that is Fowler Road, Charles Jordan Road, down through Grand Line Farms Road, Japanese Pond Road, and then up to Monster Road, Battery Beach Road. The second triggering event would be what we call the East Road, which is essentially connecting Monster Road, Little Pond Lane, and Battery Brickwood Farm Road. These, of course, serve the lots that are indicated in green, as we indicated before. The Eastern Road has a very few number of lots on it, and any developed lots on lots 10 and 1, 10, 2, and 3, 10, 4, or these two lots on lot 9, there's one of these 6 lots, would trigger all the improvements that we're talking about on this plan and throughout the rest of the set, before those lots would have an occupancy permit. Similarly, if any of the lots, if any of the lots are proposed here on big lots 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, or 8, is pulled permit is pulled from those lots, then the upgrade for showing on this plan and all details will be done again to make this large loop road to be fully connected. So those are the three major trigger events. In addition to that, of course, there are a number of the other smaller roads we've talked about already. How many roads put trail, Field Lane, Trumbling Trail, and it's a smaller connector, Hoop Lane, Gayfield Road, Border Road, Bridge Lane, Pirates Road, Odyssey Lane, Southern Jordan Road, Fern Trail, all have triggering events that will be primarily linked to development of individual homes on those short roads. In some places, there are variations. For example, on Trumbling Lane, the trail rather, because the entire road extends more than 1,000 feet, we had that situation having to develop both Hoop Lane right here, as well as the line trail, if we want to develop the first lot, lot 1-11. However, that was the only lot that was developed, and we only build roads at that point. However, if lot 10, 9, or 8 were developed, and we extend the entire road down to that point, as well as build the 12-wide Hoop Lane. I don't get into all the details, let's talk about many of the specifics about some of the improvements. The other roads, it's all here on the plan, for the most part, we've discussed a lot of detail in the past, but that in a nutshell is the triggering mechanism of the work as part of the understanding of phasing for the project. I know that since we're on the subject of phasing, the stuff has become to make about phasing, and turn over to Seth.
I'm Seth Sprague. I just briefly wanted to make it clear that this whole phasing effort comes back to the family's purpose in creating a long-term use plan to allow for future growth while minimizing changes to our present use of the land. And we're not proposing a plan now that is requiring immediate road upgrades because we're creating this plan. What we have here is a plan that requires upgrades when we change the use through creating a new residence. So I just want that to be clear.
Are there any other comments or questions by the board for the applicants? I have a question that was a topic that was discussed on the presentation with the question of credit, and in terms of how that relates to phasing and what sort of scenarios would be as the years roll by, what sort of in the works for that?
Yeah, we have met with Maureen, the town manager, to try to develop a clear plan that will link this phasing plan with the need to provide the town with a performance guarantee. And essentially what we are going to have to create is a document that shows each one of the phases and spell out how we will then provide a performance guarantee at that time for each one of the phases. There are many of them. We're going to be providing that as part of the package, so the town manager and everybody will know many years from now when a project is about to be undertaken exactly what is expected in the way of a performance guarantee. And we'll have one of the problems we're having is we won't know now exactly what it might cost in 20 years to do this work, but we'll have a format developed that will indicate what we will have to provide at that time as far as detail as Steve wanted to have as to estimated cost based on the number of feet of road widening, the number of culverts, all that sort of detail. And that format will be set up for each of the many different construction phases that may be involved in this project.
That sounds excellent. Sounds like a lot of work.
It's going to be a lot of paper, but
yes,
Sam. Are any of the lots assigned currently?
Assigned.
Yeah, there are 42 lots, and you said these are for children, and have any of the lots been assigned to the future residents?
The placement and the number of lots were developed by family members trying to anticipate their needs. And there is a general understanding within each family group about who will be able to apply to the corporation for a lease for a particular lot in the future.
Okay. Do you have any takers at present?
Nobody is clamoring at the moment.
Okay. I mean, do you expect? What's the timeline here?
It's very important for us to create this plan, obviously, because we've invested a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of financial resources to creating it. It will provide family with knowledge that should they wish to live on the property, there's mechanisms available for them to be able to do that. It's very hard to know exactly how quickly these lots will be used. You have to realize that it's going to be different for a family member building a house there because they won't actually own the land. But there have been people in the past who have gone ahead and built homes with that understanding, and I imagine it will happen in the future. But we just don't have any way to know right now how quickly that will happen. And a lot of these lots are targeted for people who are minors now.
I hope you're safe that it's not developed too quickly because I think you need rest.
Thank you. If there are no questions about that, and if you're willing, we could go on to a condition of approval.
At this point, we are running late with full ahead of us and still have a couple items remaining from the town engineer's review. So I would look forward to board, perhaps we should press on if that's acceptable to the applicant. It seems like we have almost everything taken care of, however. Any discussion on that?
Let's make a motion.
Yes, please.
Motion to the board to consider okay. The order that based on the factors on the application of Spike Corporation final subdivision review, resource permit for private access permit for 60 lots subdivision located south of Barber Beach Road, detailed to the regular January 19th, 1999 meeting of the planning board.
Okay. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? At this point. No? All those in favor of motion, raise your right hand. We have a motion to look forward to. See you just one more time.
We hope one more time. You said it first. Right. There are a couple of lingering issues. No. But we'll be wrapped up in January.
Okay. Thank you very much. We're going to wait here for our next applicant this evening. The next applicant to the board will be the Erickson private access waiver. Don Erickson is requesting a private access waiver to develop a lot at the end of Angel Point Road, lot U41-1, and we will be reviewing under section 19-79D, private access way, including public hearing. That being said, the applicant please come to the podium and give us an overview of the application and a description of what the applicant application needs at this point.
Good evening, my name is Terry Wan, I'm the chairman of them. Excuse me, I've really changed gears here. And I'm representing Donald Erickson, his personal representative from the Harriet M. Erickson estate on Angel Point Road. And Cape Elizabeth, as you know, we appeared before the planning board workshop session about a month and a half ago, at which point we had a series of tracing paper overlays that looked at the property under consideration and trying to wrestle with some of the issues of providing access and making a lot of compliance with the zoning board. So as you recall, we've had a fair amount of discussion about ways that this could proceed. And after a lot of discussion before and after the discussion before we applied to be heard tonight in private access way provision, section 1979 Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance. This is filed on November 30th, 1998. Maureen has asked me to provide you with a very brief overview of the situation. I know that you're familiar with it, but because this public hearing, I'll go over some of the details. Mr. Erickson, of course, in a spot right here, which is right now shown as 0.91 acres planned. That is at the end of Angel Point Road, which, as you know, comes off the end of Two Lights Road. Angel Point Road is a private road. It is not contained with any defined right-of-way, but does provide access to a number of homes between Two Lights Road and the end of the road currently ends the driveway of the Erickson's. You can see on the site map here, a number of homes in the vicinity. What the Erickson's would like to do is, as part of something that they state, to be able to sell off this parcel of land, which is on the south side of their home. And we've shown photographs from taking under deck right here to show the character of the land. That's 2.5 acre land, front of the Atlantic Ocean, very spectacular piece of property. As you know, from previous discussion, there's a fair amount of work done to show the land is indeed a buildable tract of land. We've had Alfred go out and established a site for a system right here. There's been an HHG 100 form that's been completed and applied for. We're doing now the minor variation of that because we initially talked about a building site left close to the ocean. After further site review and verification of wetlands, the wetlands, of course, are shown by this line right here on the property. We're looking at a building envelope on the south side, there's the present house in this area right here. I just carry the size of the building envelope, the size of the other homes in the area. You can see that while it's small relative to the size of the 2.5 acre parcel, it's certainly more than adequate to build a house. At least the size of the Erickson's present home. You can see this photograph right here. At the present time, there is no one, to my knowledge, who has an interest in buying the property, but the Erickson's have expressed a desire to move this through the private access process to make sure that all the eyes are dotted to the process as far as the board is concerned. And we have completed an application for private access review. In addition to the information we've given before you, we added a number of notes onto a drawing prepared by Owen Haskell Associates. We actually had them acquired from Owen Haskell retirement and to get some history of the property and apply it to the plan. Angel Point Road right now exists as a work on variable width around the road from Two Lights Road down to property. There is a hammerhead turnaround right here, which is partially on the lot that would be conveyed that would serve both this property here as well as the existing person property. We're saying as part of this process that if the lot were to be sold and the building permit were to be pulled, that the person that would be buying the property and building the house down there would submit as part of the application for building permit a more detailed plan that shows that would show how the turnaround would be present on board to the fire chief, making sure there was adequate frame radius and depth to that turnaround. At present time, though, it is not the Erickson's desire to install the turnaround, but to have mechanism in place, keep the approval tonight would require the person buying the lot to make the application. We are showing natural features on the property. We are adding, we have added notes, as indicated right here, that says the construction activity between 25 feet and 100 feet of spring high tide will require a DEP for a rule application. The construction activity within 25 feet of high tide will require an RPA for the DEP. And none of these are anticipated because the building envelope we're showing right here that is outside of both those envelopes. We also added a note, which the planning board has been very interested in the past, that says that any wetland building required permitting by the planning board. The building envelope we're showing uses the defined wetland boundaries established by the wetland scientist as the subject end of the building envelope, with the understanding that if the person were to build in such a way that would require any building, would have to come back before the planning board to get that amount of building and disturb the wetland approved by the planning board. However, if you recall, we had an overlay to show how the house would get out here, and we believe it's possible to build a house on the property and probably leave the neighborhood 15 to 20 feet between that southern boundary line of the wetland and the building construction will not construction occur in such a way that would not disturb any wetland areas out there. There will be a note added to the site plan saying detail will include reciprocal agreements for access over the use of the permit. In other words, turnaround will be created right here, would not only service the slot right here, the 2.5 acre lot, but also provide access and turnaround ability for the Erickson's to use it as such. Here's hydrant is located on the intersection park road, Angel Point Road, utilities will be installed around the ground, we did install the ground into the lot. We don't have any problems with the various private access standards. Restriction to only making this available to one lot. Obviously, we're only asking for it to be applied to one lot at the southern end of Angel Drive, the 20 Drive turnaround we've already talked about. Site distance was a minor concern. We started to talk about this before we got involved with it. There has been some conversations with the fire chief. There has been some clearing along Angel Drive to make sure there is adequate site distance for the fire chief's recommendation. A maintenance agreement we have included a draft of the cover for the maintenance agreement between the Erickson's and first of the department property talks about long-term maintenance of the private access way. Terry Clough, the attorney representing the Erickson's here tonight, he's the person drafted this agreement and addressed the concerns you have regarding. There are a number of issues that we talked about last time that have really required some discussion on part of the planning board, and these are enumerated in our cover. First of all, is that the initial certificate of tax got right away. The access way that we're showing right here is not included with any certificate right away, with as established two issues from back over 100 years, and we do not feel that's the issue. The road varies in width from 12 to 15 more feet in width, and does provide a certain amount of access down to property. Similarly, the issue of gravel subways and the construction travelway, I know that Steve went out there from the departing and found there was no problem with the mixed gravel road, the drainage conditions, and so forth. And again, we're not supposed to do anything to improve or disrupt the drainage on Angel Point Road. We feel that section certainly is not addressed right now. The one issue that we do have some concern with was the recommendation by Steve Harding to provide the paper that we just talked about the last application and go to the end of Angel Point Road, where it intersects with Two Lights Road. We can understand Steve's concern, however, we do have the same outlook on this being a very low-key rural condition as the private road. There's not any problems that we've identified or the county here has identified, and we feel that leaving the road in this present condition certainly will meet the requirements for access for maintenance for the foreseeable future. And we'd like to have a condition that was outlined in Maureen's memo today, leader, was condition number 3 of the first 58 road. Okay. In addition to that observation, we very thought to address this, that because they make up land holdings out here, you don't legally have the right to pay all this road when it comes off to electric business, go across private property at that point. And with that, I would turn back over to the chair for any additional comments or questions.
Okay. Thank you very much. Our first order of business by the board at this point would be to review the application submitted and determine if it is, in fact, complete for the board to be in consideration. Mark Maureen has provided a checklist with respect to requirements, no requirements, which is on right after following page 3 of the application. The one item on it indicated as pending being a stamp from the land surveyor, and that's all. So any comments by board members? Yes.
Thank you. Motion.
Thank you.
Motion to the board consider the order based on plans submitted and the facts of the application found for private access way permit for lot U41-1, located at the end of Indian Point Road, BD complete.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second motion, please.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? No, all members in favor of the motion, indicate by raising your right hand, please. We got an unanimous vote. At this point in time, the board can begin review and substantive discussion. But first, one of the things that we did have advertised for this evening was a public hearing regarding the public access waiver. And before we go into all the details, perhaps we could get here for any further information for our consideration out there. So that being said, I'll open the public hearing. Any members of the public interested in coming forward sharing ideas or thoughts or any information which might be relevant to the application, we'd be very happy to hear from you. We have a good attendance this evening, but perhaps we'll get some other time. No, we don't care whatever it is, anything that can be sort of added into the information we have is always tremendously appreciated. But hearing nobody step forward, I'll close the public hearing. And with that, the board can begin a substantive review, and I guess any comments by board members regarding information or questions for the applicant at this point in time would be appropriate. Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Regarding the plan is labeled as a site plan, and it appears as based on a standard boundary survey. Is this a plan that will be submitted to the registry of deeds for recording? The board did not have stamps because this is submitted to the plan board for review. There's always comments and questions which lead to some minor changes in the plan. Our intention is to have some such as take this information and put this in the final format, so we have their signature on it. Who would be recording plan? Recording plan, yes. I was just going to comment that the plan is quite difficult to read, and I don't know if that's the line weight is coming out of it correctly, but the line should be out of your line. I realize that Hassel such as email over copy to us and take some of your thoughts on transfer. A question regarding the board's approval of this application condition that the turnaround be left the responsibility of the future purchaser of the parcel. Is that something the board has done in the past? Is there any legal issue related to the fact that we haven't approved public access waiver using old terminology, but we don't have the turnaround in place at the time that the public access waiver was approved?
Good question, Maureen. Perhaps Maureen can help out with that.
Well, this, under the new ordinance, this is the first public access way that you would be approving. But under the old public access waiver provisions, it was routine to get the approval for the lot, and then that's why the recording is so important, because if the lot is conveyed out, whoever buys the lot and puts a building permit is supposed to be responsible for making sure all the other conditions on the waiver are enforced here.
In any event, no, I bought the lot, not the building, no need to determine such. If the applicant doesn't have rights to pave the first 50 feet because it's on private property, does the applicant clearly have a right to provide future or additional use of the road by subdividing this parcel in that first 50 feet or within any other length of the road?
That's a legal question. Let me turn over to Larry.
But the road looking out for indicating one was a very dire state of partition. At that time, it was referred to the old travel way into the seashore.
One rod wide, and that's about as specific as it got. The Supreme Court has refereed a number of debates
over rights of way over the years.
They feel held grant right of way does not include right paid, but it does include right routine maintenance.
Now, and in fact, the applicant here has already done some tree trimming to satisfy the fire chief.
I think basically the existing unpaved dirt road that been that way for about 5 years now. We can't do much about that. That answers part of it. The other part was if they don't have the right to pave it, it's implied that they do have the right, clearly have the right for their own traffic. Do they have the right for some body lot to increase traffic?
Oh, in the, this lot is already just a separate lot. It's existed this way for well over 20 years. Back in the 1880s, when this was created, it was only two lots.
I have a question for the applicant. Given the fact that the turnaround would be constructed by a future landowner of the new lot, do you have reason to believe that there is enough room for a turnaround and the septic system
without relying on the property?
Or would you just leave that to be worked out in the will it will fit?
Well, part of the property, of course, is the yard, part of the turnaround beyond the yard's property, and that's why we have the cross seasons that we've talked about before.
Okay. The turnaround right now part is on the Halix property.
Apparently would it that, is. And
does that enter into a future?
I need to make sure that the turnaround in the future is over a little bit.
And the septic system will allow for that to happen. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions by board members for the applicant or comments? Mr. Parkers?
I'd like to make a motion.
Yes.
Findings of fact, number one, I'm requesting private access way permit lot 41-1 located on Indian Point Road. Number two, the application is incomplete and public hearing was held on December 15, 1998. Number three, in accordance with the town requirements, the applicant has provided a maintenance agreement which is not yet signed. Number four, town engineer has recommended revisions to the plan that would include paving of 50 feet of Angel Point Road design the proposed turnaround. Number five, the HHD-200 form has not been updated to show the correct fill location. Number six, the application substantially complies with section 19-7-9C, private access ways. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Don Egerton for a private access way permit lot U41-1 located at the end of Angel Point Road be granted subject to the following conditions. Number one, that the maintenance agreement be signed by the applicant and submitted to the town planner. Number two, the program be signed per the town engineer comments and submitted to the town engineer for review and approval.
Number three, that the record reflect that the approved building site is depicted on the site plan and not on the HHE 200 form. And five, that there be no issue to a building permit until the above conditions have been satisfied.
Got a motion? Do I hear a second?
I will second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion of the motion?
Did I hear correctly yes. that the motion includes a payment of the first 50 feet of the
No.
Okay.
Yeah. From my recollection, a few years ago, we did a public access waiver about halfway down the same road and took a look at the sort of topo conditions where it comes out onto Two Lights Road and did not include a paved apron at that time. No, it seems logical that given the amount of traffic that's there, that it's still adequate. Any further discussion of the application or questions? Hearing none, all board members indicating approval of the motion, raise your right hand. The vote is unanimous. Thank you very much.
Should we then, are you looking for a recording plan and you'll be signing them?
Yes.
Okay.
The board doesn't sign that plat, though.
No.
You can just report it.
Just report it, okay.
But you should let me see it first.
But those corrections we talked about. Yes.
On the next item on the agenda this evening is the community pool site plan, and if the applicant could come forward and prepare whatever information they have for us to look at, we'll give you an introduction in a minute. First of all, I'd like to just introduce introduce you to the folks at home. The next application is the community pool site plan. It's an application by the town of Cape Elizabeth requesting site plan review of the community pool expansion project located at the rear of the high school, and we'll be reviewing tonight under section 19-9 for site plan completeness. And that being said, the applicant can now please introduce yourselves and present and give us an idea of the overview of the project.
Thank you. My name is Dave Sear. I live at 15 Macaulay Road in Cape Elizabeth. I'm the chair of the pool committee, which was formed in 1997 to steward the pool renovation project through the various processes that we have gone through and will go through over the next 12 months. I just have a couple of brief comments, then we'll turn the meeting over to folks from Harriman Associates. The committee has been working with Harriman Associates to develop the proposal to renovate the pool and to add a weight room to that facility for the past 12 months, but we've been working in earnest for the last couple of months to prepare the site plan and the overall plans that are being submitted to the planning board for review. The committee obviously has a keen interest in these proceedings because we have a budget that is extremely tight, and we have a timetable that I think is even tighter. My primary purpose for being here this evening is to represent the committee and to answer any questions you may have of the committee. Having said that, then I'll turn the meeting over to Frank Crabtree from Harriman Associates, who will go through and review the site plan with you.
I'm Frank Crabtree from Harriman Associates. I'm the civil environmental engineer at Harriman that's been working on this project. I'll hold this since it doesn't want to stay up there. Just briefly, that's right, just give me a second. Just briefly to show you where the project is, you're probably all familiar with that. The red here is the high school. The town office is over here. And the little black addition on the back shows you the scale of the addition we're proposing. It's a very small 5,200 square foot addition to the pool facility along with the renovation. First of all, I'd like to just go through a quick overview of the project. The project is basically a renovation of the pool, and that is meaning the pool itself isn't going to grow in size. It's going to be renovated, taken out, put back in as a new pool, but basically the same size. Of the 5,200 square foot addition, we consider only a very small part of that to be an expansion of use. In other words, about 1,100 square feet is the weight room, exercise room that was mentioned before. That's a use that doesn't currently exist. It doesn't, they don't have their own room. That is a new use. The other parts of the building are basically giving elbow room to uses that already exist. In this area of the building here, we're adding bleachers. So that the people who now stand when there's an event there can sit down and actually get out of the way, and it's a safety precaution as well. We're also adding a new entry vestibule, a new hallway, and some mechanical rooms for the filtering and other mechanical devices that already exist. So basically, the 1,100 square feet is the addition that we're talking about and providing new parking for. As far as the site goes, let me briefly go over that. We are expanding the upper parking lot. There are two parking lots, as you're familiar with the school. There's the upper parking lot, which is right now quite small, only 16 vehicles here. It also doubles in the service yard. And that makes it quite nice for parking. The lower lot has 75 spaces, and we're only proposing to work in the upper lot. We're going to expand the upper lot by adding some pavement, shown in gray. We're adding about 3,000 square feet of impervious surface pavement together with the 5,000 square feet of building area. That will allow us then to push the parking out far enough to get another whole row of parking in an area now that is crossed off because it's too tight to actually park. So that will bring us up to 30 vehicles in the upper lot, a gain of 14 spaces. Because the building is pushing up towards the lower parking lot and the grades, there's quite a grade step here. We're adding a flight of stairs in the paved walk. We're also adding a retaining wall and a small sidewalk at the bottom. This is considered as a maintenance issue on top of the existing parking lots down here. The lot is already paved to this shape. We're basically putting the retaining wall and the sidewalk at the bottom of the wall on top of that existing paved area and restriping the turnaround island here. We will do no more work on this lower lot we will lose two spaces in that lot, which will bring the total count to a gain of 12 spaces. Now, we are in three zoning districts. The entire project is in the town center zone. Then this heavy line here, which you can see on the plans you have in front of you at least, represents a 250-foot setback from the RP1 critical buffer overlay zone, which is down here off the sheet. In your handout, we do have the Woodlot Alternatives wetland assessment that shows that down here, but this represents the outside edge of the buffer. So the buffer does come across the end of the building and the end of this parking. This is also a shoreline zone. Now at this point, I could go through the review comments. We've received review comments both from the town planner and the town engineer. If that's what you'd like me to do, or we can take questions of what I've presented so far. Would you like me to go through the review comments?
I think at this point in time, what we need to do as a board is sort of formally receive the application, deem it complete, and then launch into specifics and questions that we might have. So that gives us a good overview to start from. So I guess at this point in time, what we'll do as a board is just sort of go through the list of materials that have been submitted to us and see if it is, in fact, ready for us to begin review. So at this point, I would ask fellow board members if they have any comments or questions. Yes?
I'd like to make a motion.
Yes, Mr. Parkhurst.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the town of Cape Elizabeth for an expansion of the community pool located at the rear of high school, of the high school, excuse me, be deemed complete.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion or questions in terms of what applies to what in terms of what we have received? We have a, again, we have a site plan review submission checklist, which Maureen has prepared, indicating that everything in the ordinance which is asked for in an application has been completed. With only one not applicable, being a method of solid waste storage and disposal, which presumably is already accommodated by the high school. So if there were any other aspects of the plans that board members have any questions about, we could at this time have clarifications from the applicant. Hearing no further discussion then, all those on the board in favor of approval of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. And we have a unanimous vote for completeness. Is that at this point in time, we can begin a review of substantive issues, and if the applicant would like to present further detailed information as to why certain things were done or how you've approached the project, we'd be interested in hearing that.
All right. I'll go down through those review comments right now that we have. I believe you've got those in front of you.
Yes.
The town planner had three review comments. The first was parking calculations, and it was apparent that I wasn't clear enough, basically, in the calculations in what I submitted in your package, which is this, basically this handout here. The numbers Maureen seemed to agree with, but the way I got to them was a little bit unclear. Basically, the 1,116 square foot addition, which we're talking about as that the exercise room, which is a new use, we're providing spaces as a municipal use, the one space for every 150 square feet of that use, which is 7.4 spaces, and then with the assumption that there may be an additional staff person needed either now or at some time in the future for that program, we added in one staff person, which would be 1.27, bringing it up to just under 9 spaces. So we said 9 is the number of spaces that we need. We supplied as much as we could in the upper lot and still make it a functional and safe space, and that was the total of 12, as I was mentioning before. So we're providing a little bit more than we actually need, 3 extra spaces. Also in that comment, there was a comment to the town engineer's comment about one additional handicapped space, and that was one that didn't get shown on the plans. We show 4 right now at this end near the pool. Here would be the new pool access doorway here, and at a very gentle grade, we would have access to these 4 spaces. There are 100, and with this addition, there'll be 103 spaces, and the ADA cutoff is 100 spaces for 4. Therefore, we need the 5th space, and we missed that. Basically, that was one that didn't get put on the plan. We can add that 5th space in very easily, and we still keep the same count. We'll just change one of our spaces that we have now into a handicap, so we still have a gain of 12 total spaces. The second comment by the town planner was lighting, and the comment was that we proposed 3 30-foot high light poles, new light poles for the upper parking lot. These poles, these are the ones shown as circled in red here, just to make them stand out for you across the top. There are 3 30-foot poles are basically used for lighting large areas. We use those to hopefully distribute the light the best we could throughout the whole area. The concern from the planner was that may be a little tall, it may look too industrial. We can lower those. We've done another calculation with 20-foot poles, which would be giving the same light levels. We would have to increase by adding one extra fixture on the middle pole, but we wouldn't have to add an extra pole. So we would be fine with doing that. Either way is fine with us. If you prefer the shorter poles, that's fine. It would probably look a little more like a human space rather than a big industrial space. That was a good comment. There is another light pole down here by the walk, because this walk turns a corner, it could become relatively dark. That's a lower, I believe it is a 15-foot pole, I believe, down here with a smaller wattage. So that's a question. I guess we will need some response from it sometime. But we are fine with using the shorter poles. There is no problem with that. The fixtures on these poles you also have in your packet. They're basically a square fixture with a sharp cutoff feature. You don't see the bulb. It's up inside the fixture, so there's a sharp cutoff of the light. These fixtures are meant to represent the new fixtures used on the school campus, basically the ones over near the new middle school and also the tennis courts. So we're trying to keep a fixture that is looking the same style.
Is there any lighting on the lower lot now? What's this?
Currently, there are 3 lights that light the lower lot, and they're tall wooden poles with spotlights. There's one here which we're going to have to slide over about 15 or 20 feet. We aren't going to change it in any way, but we're going to have to move it out of the way of these new spaces. It shines down into this lot. There's one at this end shining back this way, and then up on a chimney of the building there's another one. So there are 3 spotlights lighting the lower lot. And that seems to be doing a good job. I was down there after dark tonight looking at it, and that lower lot seems to be well lit. The upper lot at this point isn't very well lit, and the the improvements we're making would make the upper lot very well lit. And the third comment from the planner is signage. And it's just a, I guess it's just a comment. We didn't propose any signage in your packet other than one handy, or the handicap signs. And the comment was, we may want to put some type of a small sign denoting the new entrance to the pool. And again, that seems to be something that we can do. And I wasn't sure whether that was being proposed. But it's something we can do above the pool entrance. It will be quite obvious because there's going to be a that octagonal shape is not a building, actually. It's like a canopy out here. So it'll be a focal point which will draw people to that point with or without a sign, I think.
Okay.
Moving on to the town engineer's comments. He had 12 comments. The first one was not was really just a summary of the project and showing that there was about 8,200 square feet of additional impervious surface. The second was a discussion of the stormwater, and because we feel this is a very minor change to the site, and we're not proposing to change any of the drainage ways. There are two pipes discharging now away from the site on the lower side of the lower lot and the building. We're not changing those. We're routing our stormwater back into those same pipes. So we're not even messing with the outfalls into the wetland area. Steve seemed to agree that in his comment here that this will be a minimal increase, and therefore he didn't feel we needed any detention for this facility. The third concern, comment, was to do with the lack of snow storage space. And he made the comment that I had suggested removing the guardrail, and I guess I had. We talked about it on the phone, but I wasn't realizing at the time all the history of why the guardrail was being asked to be there by the maintenance supervisor of the high school, and it was to try to prevent four-wheel drive vehicles from running up and down the embankment more than it was actually there for a safety issue from the top. This guardrail is proposed along this upper set of parking spaces. And with that information, I guess we would prefer to keep the guardrail to at least, especially on this end where it's a little steeper. When this embankment is finally built, it'll be a little steeper than it is today. This end over here by the access road is not as steep. And we would propose that we keep the guardrail here and that we remove some of the guardrail on this end enough to allow the snow plowing that the Public Works Director would like to see. I think this is an issue we need to work out with the Public Works to see just how much snow storage space he'd like to have. But it sounds to me that the guardrail is being requested for a legitimate reason that I guess at this point there are four-wheel drive vehicles running up and down that embankment. And if it's improved and landscaped, the maintenance man would like to see that stopped. Going on to number four, I'm going right through these. If you want to stop me at any time, go ahead.
It might be helpful at this point in time, since we have a public hearing scheduled for next month also, and I think most of the members of the board have read through these, if we sort of allow board members to raise whichever questions they may have about them, and as long as we have you here, then
okay,
be able to have you respond. Do any board members have any questions about anything so far in the application? Yes, Tom.
I guess a couple of questions. The procedure indicates that the board may hold a public hearing next month. We haven't discussed and decided that mm-hmm. wouldn't in case be the fact. I congratulate the building committee and all of the hard work that the building committee members and the team have put into this project. Swimming has a long tradition in Cape. I was at the council meeting when I heard the public stand up. An awful lot of elderly people in town have stood up and supported this project where they might not always support school projects because of the tax impact. They certainly supported this project for the benefits of health. It's fortuitous you've come here this evening, the day when the today's paper has a coverage on competitive swimming in the state of Maine. I'm a retired competitive swimmer myself, and to see improvements of this kind for this type of sports, plus the general public, I think is commendable. I also have two students at Cape Elizabeth High School, one of whom drives the school as a senior in park, so I'm well aware of the parking situation at the high school, and as a parent, I've gone there at night. This board reviewed the middle school, or at least I was on the board at the time, that the middle school project was approved. And there were several issues as part of that project. I understand this is now a community facility or a town facility. I believe the town owns all of the school buildings, but the improvements for this project come out of town side budget, not from the school side budgets. However, given the fact that there are a lot of elderly people using this facility, given the fact that a lot of the uses in the evening, and particularly prime season, appears to be much of the time during the winter, the short days and dark time, it has always occurred to me for any evening activity where I've had to go behind and park behind the school, there's a tremendous dark spot at the bottom of that drive as you turn the corner. And there's also a lot of activities that occur on that corner. There's parking for the tennis courts. There's evening soccer games. And while I don't have any intention of holding up this project or holding this project ransom for those type of improvements, I think it really behooves whomever has control over that area of the site, if for no other reason, for a liability reason, to look into the illumination issues there. Hearing and other issue that I'd like to see addressed is the issue of spotlights being used to light areas when you're driving up the hill away from the lower parking lot. There's a merging at the top of the hill that's always a little bit problematic, but if you're driving into spotlights or towards spotlights, particularly as a pedestrian walking upstairs, if you're walking towards spotlights and you get a silhouette effect, it's a real opportunity for injury. So I think we have to be very careful about the use and the relocation of spotlights. They're typically very much discouraged in terms of providing adequate light, an even level of light in high use areas. Something that in terms of seating, could you just give me an idea? I don't think the answers need to be addressed tonight, but a question I would have is, regardless of what is the bottom line on the parking is, just for the record and so everyone clearly understands, I'd like to know what the seating capacity is versus what the standing capacity is, or what typically is expected at a swim meet. And I know that varies depending upon the event, but you've given us the square footages for the exercise room, and I think having an understanding of the assembly or the seating area would be helpful. Bus parking is something that goes on with all high school athletics. Swim meets are often held at this pool, relay events, and those sorts of things. So I think the plan or the application should address parking versus other bus parking versus other parking for the site. And there should be an understanding, I think, between the town and the school, if there isn't already, and perhaps that's just a letter, I don't know. But I know that, well, I don't know for certain, but sometimes students park back here and they may or may not be permitted to, and there's conflicts that develop over the use of this rear parking lot. So in terms of numbers, there may be an indication that there's a certain existing number and there's no conflicts, but I think clarification and an understanding between a letter from the school department and the town would be helpful as a planner. I'm a registered landscape architect. If it's helpful to your budget and you would could save some money eliminating shrubs, I would support that to the extent that they generally are high maintenance, and if they're in high traveled areas, they can become damaged by snow. And particularly with school facilities, I like the use of trees and shade trees to break up spaces, but shrubs I see are often damaged by plows and our initial investment that really doesn't benefit the project long term. But I'll leave that up to the building committee to make that decision. If there's any way of eliminating some length of that retaining wall, I certainly would encourage you to do so if that saves money on the budget. if there's a way of doing a 2-to-1 slope or a 2.5-to-1 slope or something like that and could be stabilized with planting, I wouldn't have any issue with that. The other item is that I know there's access to the pool. There's several things that go on here. There's certainly an awful lot of handicapped accessible use. There's canoes, kayaks that are brought into the facility, and they generally just bring vans in and park up in front of the door. And there appears to be, from the plan, enough room to get a van in there, back it up, and get it out. My question is that if one has an accessible van with a wheelchair in it and comes into the closest accessible parking space, the space indicated on the plan is only 18 feet. The maneuvering area is only 18 feet wide. And typically for parking spaces, I think the minimum distance is about 40 to 42 feet. So if you just confirm with your next presentation, I don't know if you have a traffic turning radiuses or whatever that would show how that works, and primarily if there's issues with backing up near that. I think there's a propane tank there, and if the turf is going to be damaged, and I think as we see around a lot of the school facilities, if the sidewalks need to be wider to accommodate those types of vehicles, I think it would be easier now just to do that than try to go with less pavement and more impact and ongoing maintenance costs. That's generally the list of items I had.
Okay. Any other questions or comments by board members? Would board members have an opinion on the possibility of a public hearing for this project at some point in the future?
I think we should have one for sure.
Should we? For the next meeting?
Okay. Yes.
Any other sort of general impressions? I have a question, and perhaps there's a little information you could bring back next time. First of all, I'm in favor of the 250 watt lights on lower poles if they can work and give you adequate illumination, as opposed to 400 watt lights on 30-foot poles. Just as sort of a development standard, it does give a facility a sort of more welcoming feel, if you will. Not as visible from the other side of town, all of that. But in terms of the logic of the parking calculation, which shows a fairly extensive amount of new seating resulting in 9 parking spaces, I would be interested in finding out what the code-approved seating capacity is of the existing pool versus the code-approved seating capacity of the new pool. And how that affects parking on the site. And if that involves non-simultaneous use of parking spaces or whatever the plan is, so we can see how many cars will be descending upon this place at any given point in time, it would be very good to have that as a sort of basis in reviewing the application. I kind of find it hard to look at an empty pool deck and think that there's a few hundred fire chief approved public seating spaces there. But I understand that it's a complex issue on a larger campus, and I'm sure that you all have a plan for how to deal with it, because the cars will still come. That being said, anything else from other members? Yes, Nancy.
How did you arrive at 5 handicapped spaces?
That is both the Maine Human Rights and the United States ADA code. There are, for 100 spaces, there would be 100 parking spaces total, there would be 4 designated handicap. And as it was pointed out, we have 103, so we need to go that one extra. Anything over 100 has to be 5.
I'm just wondering if, realistically, that reflects the use on handicapped people of the pool. I am a pool person myself, and I can't answer that question myself. I just wondered if anybody had the experience to gauge whether five parking spaces would be enough for the handicap.
We could look at it several mornings and find out.
Thank you.
I'll send Marie.
Wouldn't Community Services be the one that would have that information? No?
No.
Chairman, I would
yes.
move that the application be tabled to the regular January 19th, 1999 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second. Thank you. Second. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? None being heard, all those in favor indicate by raising your right hands. We have a unanimous vote. We'll look forward to seeing you again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, okay. Excuse me, we have one more thing on the previous application. Strictly internal discussion as to whether or not a site visit is needed between now and next month when you come back. A site visit by members of the Planning Board. Is everyone on the board familiar with the site? Familiar enough with the improvements that mm-hmm. you can tell what they are?
Okay.
Then thank you very much. We're all set. The next item on the agenda this evening are the tower zoning amendments. A request by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council to make a recommendation for amendments to the zoning ordinance regulating telecommunication facilities. This evening specifically, we will be reviewing under section 19-10-3, which includes provision for a public hearing in this process. That being said, I'll introduce the project by just saying that this is something that has been worked on so far to date extensively by a couple of town boards now, and Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, has been in continuous contact and familiarity with the process and the details of the project, and so I'd like to turn over the meeting at this point to her so she can kind of give us a summary of what this is all about.
Thank you. What I'd like to do very briefly, because I've been getting a lot of calls from people, and I know there's a lot of people that are very concerned about this, and I don't have to speak for the Planning Board to say that we like to have people come to public hearings. Most of the time the room is empty. What I'd like to do very briefly, because I know you've been sitting here a while, is just to let you know what has happened up to this point, so that everyone in this room basically has the same amount of information that they're working with before the board starts discussing this and you get to tell them what you think about the project. I was very pleased to see Dick Dahlbeck walk in this evening, because Dick was one of the members of the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, and this really all started with that committee, because the town rewrote our zoning ordinance, and we had at least one citizen ask us to look at our tower regulations. And that committee decided, I believe quite rightly, that their task was large enough and that they would defer the zoning ordinance regulations for towers to a later date. So we have a new zoning ordinance that was adopted by the town council in May of last year. And at that time, the town council also said to the planning board, here, there's this letter from this resident. We think you need to look at the tower regulations and do some work on them. Planning board had, I think, one meeting on it and decided that this was a big issue. And it wasn't something that should just be decided at one meeting. And they recommended back to the town council that a committee needs to be established to look at the whole policy of telecommunications in the town. And the council agreed. And they created, in October of last year, the Telecommunications Facilities Task Force. It had seven members on it. Three of them were representatives from the general public, the citizens of the town. There were also representatives from the town council, planning board, and the zoning board. They met six times. And there was a pretty steep learning curve on this issue, because there's a lot of stuff to get into. They came up with starting in January, meeting six times, came up with a report which they presented to the council, and the planning board is basically working with their report tonight. I have copies of the report in my office. If anyone wants a copy, they can come see me tomorrow morning. We did make some copies and leave them at the back of the room, and I'm assuming that they're basically distributed around the room by this point. But one of the things that happened when this committee began to review this whole set of tower regulations is they reviewed the federal law. And the federal law was passed in 1996, and they came to the conclusion that the law really limited what local governments can do to regulate towers. At the time the law was being considered in Congress, there was heavy lobbying on behalf of the industry to completely preempt local authority to review towers at all. So the good news is that we still have some authority. The bad news is we don't have complete authority as we do with other land use regulations. But however, under the federal law, we do clearly have authority to regulate towers. However, we cannot promote the creation of new towers in the town. We can't completely prohibit them. We couldn't ban them throughout the town. The federal law clearly states we cannot do that. We cannot discriminate between individual providers so that if you let Company A come in, you have to let Company B come in, and you have to let Company C come in. And since the FCC has issued 4 to 5 licenses in every area, we're basically looking at providing sufficient room for up to 5 providers per service area. It also clearly states that local governments cannot look at the health impacts from these facilities. And I know no one's going to like that, but the federal government has said that local governments are basically preempted from establishing their own regulations about the health impacts. That's regulated by the FCC. I'm not going to debate with you whether or not they're actually doing any inspections of these sites, but just so you know what we're working with, the federal law, and I want to quote these two sections, that the regulation of the placement, construction, and modification of personal wireless service facilities by any state or local government or instrumentality thereof, one, shall not unreasonably discriminate among providers of functionally equivalent services, and two, shall not prohibit or have the effect of prohibiting the provision of personal wireless services. And secondly, no state or local government or instrumentality thereof may regulate the placement, construction, and modification of personal wireless service facilities on the basis of the environmental effects of the radio frequency emissions to the extent that such facilities comply with the Commission's regulations concerning such emissions. So the Tower Committee came up with some recommendations within these limitations. They looked at and identified who the current license holders are for the area that Cape Elizabeth is located within. They inventoried existing towers and tall structures in the town. And there was general agreement that existing facilities for cellular communications are basically adequate, that most of the town pretty much gets good coverage with the cellular phone. However, there is a new technology that's on the horizon that's entering the area called personal communication services. And in this technology, which is based on digital rather than analog technology, which is the cellular phones, it functions at a higher bandwidth and it has a weaker signal. PCS Communications offers many new services. It's the growth area in telecommunications. But because the PCS signal is not as powerful as cellular signals, it has a much smaller radius. And I have done a lot of reading on this. I just want to quote something that I got from one of you that's in the audience tonight from a magazine called Network News, which is an advocate for consumers. And it states that they're estimating 100,000 new cellular towers are scheduled to go online across the country by the year 2000. An additional 4 new PCS carriers were recently approved by the FCC for each area. That system will add many hundreds of thousands more. PCS antennas need to go every 2 to 8 miles apart. That's 2 to 8 miles apart times 4 carriers. The systems don't share frequency, so they all need their own antennas. So the issue that this committee was facing was that basically they agreed that we probably had to allow the construction of additional antennas in the town of Cape Elizabeth. It was not a conclusion that anyone was happy about. But what they came to that conclusion, they decided on a multi-level approach. First of all, to minimize new tower construction as much as possible while still providing adequate townwide coverage. The fear is that if we adopt a regulation that does not provide adequate coverage, that we'll end up in court, we'll be sued, and we'll have to allow the tower construction anyway. Secondly, we're trying to capitalize as much as possible on what we call stealth technology. And this is technology where they don't have to build a new tower, where they can install antennas in existing facilities. And the examples that we see most often are places like flagpoles and church steeples, and that if you use these types of antennas, you don't have to have a new tower constructed. It's not very visible, and you can still provide that service that the federal government says that we have to provide throughout town. And the third thing that the committee did is that they decided that it was about time that the town regulated amateur wireless facilities for the first time. So up until now, ham radio operators have been able to erect antennas and towers as they deem fit, and this committee decided that we would establish some regulations that would govern how those towers get erected. So where do we put the towers? Just grab the zoning map. This is the zoning map for the town of Cape Elizabeth. And we put it in color so that it's easier to understand. All of the yellow, the gold, and the orange are residentially zoned areas. There are no industrially zoned areas in the town at all. The commercially zoned areas, there's a little area right up in here that I can cover with my finger. This big purple area right here is the town center. There's a very small area right in here, which is where you have the good table and agway. And there's a pinkish area right in here, which is where the MIC is located. Those are all business zones in town. The rest of the town is zoned either resource protection, which are the green areas, or residential, which are the yellow and the gold and the orange areas. Many communities have dealt with tower regulations by allowing them as uses in commercial and industrial zones. But that didn't look like an approach that would work in the town of Cape Elizabeth and still provide adequate coverage. So what we're trying to do instead is create a brand new district that sits on top of these other areas, and we call it the Tower Overlay District. It's a concept that works for people that don't have commercial and industrial areas. I did discover that it's very similar to a technique that's being used by the Cape Cod Commission down in Massachusetts. So where do we put these tower overlay districts? And if you want to move, I don't think anyone here would mind if you did that. But when we did our inventory, we know right off that there's an area right in here off of Spurwink Ave where we already have the largest tower in town. And there's five or six towers up in there. So the first thing the committee agreed is that we already have towers there. Let's call that a tower overlay district. Since there's already a tower there, let's try to get as much coverage for the entire town as we can, so that we can minimize the construction of new towers. And what I've done here is we talked about the radius of coverage for this PCS communication at the higher band. It's determined by the strength of the signal, which can go 2 to 8 miles, but it's also limited by topography, and it's limited by the height of the tower. So we're working with here are circles that are just shy of 2 acres. They're 10,000 square feet. So if you look at this site here, I've drawn a circle that shows you the estimated area that particular site can cover with PCS communications. Just as a caveat, we did have a provider who was testing this site for their own use, and they were willing to provide us with the information of their test results. And this darker area right here is the actual coverage that we're getting from that site with an antenna that's in the 180-foot range. So these circles can probably get a little smaller or a little larger,
but they're seen to be useful for planning purposes. So the question is, what do we do about the rest of town? We've got this area right here covered, but obviously there are parts of town that are left out. The next thing the committee said is, well, let's look at abutting communities and see what we can do with abutting communities. We looked at Scarborough. They don't have anything near the line with Cape Elizabeth, so we can't rely on any kind of overlap coverage from existing facilities in Scarborough. We did look at South Portland, and there are facilities in South Portland that are currently existing and comply with South Portland's ordinances. I did not try to use any facilities in South Portland that they are currently fighting in court. That didn't seem to be appropriate. So this circle right here is an estimate of the amount of area in Cape Elizabeth that we can serve with overlap from existing South Portland facilities. And again, this can go back a little or forward a little depending on topography. So we've got this little area right in here that doesn't get served. And then we looked at the area that everybody's interested in. And this is a part of Cape Elizabeth that is very densely populated. It's a portion of Cape Elizabeth that we were expecting people to want to have PCS services. And so the committee looked at some existing tall structures. And we looked at this little space right in the middle, which is the water tower in Shore Acres. We also looked at the Coast Guard property at Two Lights. And we looked at the Two Lights State Park that's owned by the state. And it was the committee's recommendation that it would probably be easier for an industry to work with the water district than it would be to have to work with the state or the federal government. We contacted the water district. And they were a willing property owner. They haven't committed to doing anything. They don't know if their structure is sufficient for holding stuff, and that's something they would have to work with. But generally, they're not opposed to being rezoned a tower overlay district. So that's why this site was chosen. And as you can see by this big red circle, what it does is it provides service to a large area. The whole southeastern part of Cape Elizabeth could be served by some kind of facility in this area. We still have this area right here that doesn't get service. The expectation was that we might be able to use some of the existing tall structures in Fort Williams and employ that stealth technology that I talked about, hiding something in a flagpole or a lighthouse or something, and that would be able to cover this small area up here. Secondly, we've got this area of the Sprague Corporation property that's also outside of our circles. It's a very sparsely populated area. It'll probably be one of the last areas that the industry will want to go to. And we figured that if they had to, we might be able to use some stealth technology efforts with the Spurwing Church. But for right now, we would leave it up to the property owners to see if they wanted to try something on their own. One other thing that affects this is that when the FCC sells licenses, they require anyone who holds a license to provide service to 80% of that area within 5 years or they lose their license. And that's another reason why we know that this is something that's coming into the town and why the council appointed this committee. Just to let you know, the Tower Overlay District is a district that requires site plan review by the planning board, and in addition to all the standards that the planning board would typically look at through site plan review, there's a whole series of additional standards that they would have to look at just for the tower, such as buffering, lighting, whether or not there is lighting, signage, and requirements that the provider co-locate. That is, that they would not be allowed to build a new tower unless they could prove that there was no existing tower or other location that they could put their antenna in prior to that. Just briefly, for amateur wireless radio communications, the provisions in this package that we're talking about is that if you're a ham radio operator and you want to install an antenna at the top of your property, any antenna that extends from the highest point of your structure 15 feet up, you can do as of right. From 15 feet to 25 feet, you would need a building permit. From 25 feet to 50 feet, you would need a building permit, and you would have to comply with what we call a 125% setback. And that is a setback that's applied to towers and to amateur facilities, which is for your height, you have to go back that much of your setback plus another 25%. And then if you were an amateur wireless facility person and you wanted a very large tower that was over 50 feet high, you would have to apply for a tower overlay district. So I just wanted to do that.
Thank you very much, Maureen. That was a lot of information condensed into a very short amount of time, but an excellent summary. At this point in time, now that we sort of know what we're dealing with, we have scheduled a public hearing for this evening. One of the, just to let you know what we're doing this evening first, is the town council, in before adopting any ordinance that has an impact on land use, the town council requires the planning board to review the ordinance and recommend back to the town council whether we recommend it or not recommend it for adoption. So it gets drafted in an ordinance committee, it then gets reviewed by planning board, then it comes to a public planning board meeting where we decide whether or not this ordinance gets passed on in effect to the town council, and the town council is the body that would actually adopt the proposed ordinance and determine whether or not it becomes added to the ordinances of the town. So subsequent to the public hearing, we will enter into discussion amongst ourselves about how the proposed ordinance relates to the need at hand, the demonstrated need at hand, and then vote and decide on whether or not to recommend it to the town council for adoption or not for adoption. That being said, any member of the public would, yes, Mr. Parker.
Before we begin the public hearing, I'd like to, if I might, just make one suggestion. There's a terrific amount of people here tonight, and I think I know why they're all here. I would like to make a suggestion. I would like to pass it sort of through the board to see if the board is in agreement with me or not. May shorten this meeting up somewhat. I would like to make the suggestion for the board to consider that when we do consider this ordinance or technical amendments, that the Shore Acres Tower Overlay Zone be dropped from our proposal to forward to the town council.
Mr. Emery.
I can't support that in as much as that was brought from the committee that promulgated the or the study committee that Mr. Carter served on. That was a recommendation of the study committee. I have no problem whatsoever the planning board sending to the council all of the public comments that we have, any concerns that the planning board has with that, but I'm not sure we have enough information with respect to other usable sites in town this evening. I would prefer to see the matter tabled this evening and have it brought under further consideration by the planning board rather than just carte blanche say that we're going to drop this. Because my concern is, well, I guess before everyone gets up, I would also like to know how many people in the audience are amateur radio operators, because I certainly think they have a concern that may be different than the people in Shore Acres. I'd like to know who all of us who are here have cell phones. And again, I'm not saying because one has a cell phone, it means that one should have a tower in their backyard, either. That's not my purpose, but I think the town planner brought up the fact that part of the issue here is serving different parts of town. But to get back to Steve's comments specifically, I would prefer to have the matter tabled and go back to further consideration by the planning board, because my concern is then it's going to end up in an RC district, it's going to end up at there's any other number of areas where it's going to end up. And I think everyone needs to shoulder this equally and fairly. I think another way of asking the question or dealing with the issue, we have innumerable letters here from the public. I think if the planning board in its deliberation acknowledges the public concern, the safety issues, particularly where the public I think has heard the issue that we're unable, believe it or not, to consider health issues with respect to anything that deals with local regulation is beyond any idea of living in a free country. But that issue alone is enough to, I think that's 90% of what I read in the letters that were here this evening, and I'm sure is a lot of concern that the applicants have. I think there are good questions that have been raised, whether we're talking about the tower at Shore Acres or the lighthouse at Fort Williams, the steeple, perhaps a future tower at the Levitt property. Whether existing towers that are on smaller lots that don't meet the setback requirements can in fact be applied for use as stealth technology. So I don't mind whatsoever attaching all of the concerns that the planning board has. Certainly the council, some council members were here earlier, but the council will hear everything that the public has concerns over this evening. I think what I would be helpful as a planning board member is I can't imagine what it's like to live in a neighborhood and find out that there's going to be a proposal for a 180-foot tower or something else like that and have all the concerns about health, safety, and welfare. But I think the real issue here may lie with the council when this issue comes before the council. I think it would be helpful to the planning board if we had a show of hands of all the residents of Shore Acres who are here and all who oppose this project based on several issues, proximity to their house, health, safety, and welfare, and any number of other issues. That may dilute a little bit the impact of having 100 people march up before the microphone and each testify individually. The other way to do it is to limit each individual's time or some other method, or to try to avoid redundant statements. But I feel reluctant to drop the issue of Shore Acres off this agenda this evening.
Thank you. And do any other board members have any reaction to Mr. Emery's suggestion?
Well, my original request was to basically poll the board and see how the individual board member felt.
Any other comments on Mr. Parker's proposal?
Can we take a poll?
Sure.
Thank you. As you suggested.
Yeah, I would not vote in favor of just dropping it carte blanche this evening.
No, take a poll.
Well, that was Steve.
No, take a poll of people as you suggested.
Oh, no, I think
I was referring to polling the board first.
Oh.
With respect to dropping the overlay district in reference to Shore Acres off out of this.
I'd be opposed to that. We haven't even had a hearing.
Right. I would be opposed to it also, especially after witnessing what has happened in communities where in a vacuum of provisions being made, service providers can come in and propose things which are totally unacceptable.
I would oppose dropping it also.
I oppose it.
I oppose it.
I mean, I would add further that the whole structure of the issue is ultimately one for town council to grapple with. That if the ordinances of the town only allow coverage of half the town, and a carrier comes to town and is told basically they can't do business here, if the town wants to shoulder the defense of that type of circumstance, the town can, but we are really dealing here at this board with land use issues and discussing recommendations on land use, not the sort of damage control of the town itself. That being said, I think having a public hearing is a good thing to do. A lot of people have come out to share their opinions with us. That being said, we could be here a long time. I would urge people to say things to us and share information with us. However, as chair, I will limit discussion if too much repetitive information is presented to us. Our only other choice is to say pick an arbitrary time, say 11 o'clock, and just cut the meeting off and not allow people the chance to talk. That being said, any further discussion by board members?
I just have one comment, Mr. Wilcox.
Yes.
I personally feel that the actual location of any proposed tower is, in the truest sense, probably a political decision to be made. The Planning Board and the Telecommunications Facilities Task Force are not political bodies. We review the technical information. The actual decision as to where the tower overlay districts will be located, I believe strongly, is a matter for the Town Council to consider. Thank you.
Yes, that's true. If the town wants to shoulder litigation with a service provider for a few years, they're welcome to do it. But that being said, we have a proposal that has been crafted which tries to address the needs of the town in order to come up with the best land use plan in the face of what is an onslaught of demand that is without a doubt coming. Part of the reason we haven't seen it yet is because we're not on the Route 9, on the I-95 corridor. We're sort of off to the side, but we do have demand that is substantial locally, and coverage will have to be provided eventually for it, unless the technology does another incredible leap and totally changes on us. That being said, any further input from the board?
A point of clarification. We have language in front of us that talks about overlay districts. I heard the town planner state that an overlay district may not be established until someone applies for a tower location, and is that correct?
What you have before you tonight is actually three different actions. One would be to adopt the zoning amendment text, and once you do that, you've created an entity called a tower overlay district. And I guess I wanted to spend a minute on that, because I believe that by creating that entity, that the town has created a mechanism for the council to respond to a provider before we get sued. Secondly, you have a proposal to amend the comprehensive plan, because there's nothing in the comprehensive plan that talks about towers, and we always want to make sure that our comp plan and our zoning ordinance are consistent with each other. The third item you have is an actual proposed rezoning of two areas with a request to rezone a third area. So there's a proposal to create a tower overlay district at the property at 351 Spurwink Ave, a proposal for a rezoning of the property that is owned by the water district where the water tower is on Shore Acres, and a request by the fire chief to also create a tower overlay district on the Levitt property.
Thank you.
That being said, at this point in time, I will open the public hearing. Any member of the community interested in addressing the board and sharing information with us, please come to the podium, give us your name and address, and give us a brief summary of your opinions and insights. Thank you.
My name is Alex McIntosh. I live on Smuggler's Cove, and I'm sure a lot of people here tonight will be able to give a certain perspective, a human perspective, on the placement of the towers. What I wanted to do was to come in as someone who uses a cellular phone fairly frequently and give the board here a few suggestions on, if we do have to put these things in, what are ways that we can put them in that will have minimal impact on one particular group, which is the birds of Maine. There have actually been a lot of studies done as to the impact that these towers have on birds. And so what I wanted to do is, we've all been sitting here for a while. I'm sure you're all tired and wanting to go home and trying to stay awake. If you can put yourselves outside for a few minutes, spring or summer, one of the things that you probably enjoy most when you're taking your walks or walking your kids, or if you're out hunting or what have you, are the birds. And so what I did is I put together here just a few short suggestions on ways to construct these towers. So as I said, we're going to get, I'm sure you'll get some good feedback on the human perspective. What I wanted to do is just take a minute to go through this. Cape Elizabeth and Maine residents enjoy birds, whether it's tourism, people coming on field trips, hunting, the aesthetics themselves. I don't know how many people here have backyard bird feeders. Chances are, if you do, this is something that's important to you. Local bird clubs, school, biology, and nature classes, and photographers are all obviously interested and enjoy birds. What I want to do is just take a minute to talk about how poorly designed or poorly placed towers can impact birds. And if you look at the flag that actually, interestingly enough, has an eagle on the top of it, or this one here, depending on your perspective. Towers 200 feet or taller are, by law, they need to be lit for airline safety, and they're generally flashing lights or blinking lights on the top. And what happens is most birds migrate at night, and so they're flying through the sky. It's pitch black, and what usually happens is they will be attracted to these lights as they're flying. And the very large towers, if you had something that was a number of 100 feet going up, they have guide wires that come off the sides of them. And so what you have is you have literally millions of birds that are flying through the air at night, going straight. They see a light, and especially on a foggy night, which we sometimes get being on the coast, they're attracted to light and they start circling around. And so if you look at, let's say, the flag with the eagle, you can picture thousands and thousands of birds in a night flying around. And then you put wires, metal wires down that go for hundreds of feet, and you can imagine what happens to the birds after a number of nights of that. Also, a number of towers recently have been put in areas that have less human habitation. And these can sometimes be along migratory paths, along shores, on top of hills, adjacent or inside of nature preserves. And Cape Elizabeth is very lucky because we have a number of community outdoor spaces. One thing that's very dangerous is putting towers next to those areas. If you flip two pages past, what are the numbers? I tried to get a sense, even though the research is fairly new, of, you know, what does this mean? What are we worried about? Is it just a few birds that visit our backyard bird feeders, or something more substantial? The numbers show that right now between 2 million and 4 million birds are killed in collisions with communication towers just in eastern North America every year, 2 to 4 million. Tall towers, generally ones over 200 feet, will kill on average of 2,500 birds a night during the migratory season. That's one tower. And right now there are at least 75,000 towers in the country above 200 feet, and another 100,000, as we heard, are going to be built in the next 10 years. So if you picture thousands and thousands of towers built with guide wires coming off and birds migrating, being attracted to the light, the loss of 2 to 4 million birds a year is fairly substantial. The last page, and then I'll move aside, is just some recommendations that I've gotten from a number of different groups on, if we have to build these towers, what are some things we can do now that's that'll make it safer? Ostensibly, that's the charge of the group. If you're going to build it, how do you build it the right way? One suggestion is to place the towers in existing structures. Maureen mentioned that, for stealth. Generally, the shorter the tower, the fewer birds killed. And one suggestion is monopoles, or one single pole, is always safer than a pole that has a number of guy wires that are coming off of it, because those are just like guillotines that birds are flying into. If possible, little or no lighting at all. The more lighting you have, the more birds you'll kill, because the light attracts them as they're flying. And if possible, to place the towers away from or outside of nature preserves where birds are flying. And the last, which may not be something that is doable for this committee, which is to put highly visible paints on the tower. That may not work for aesthetic reasons. But again, just something to consider if you hunt, you watch birds, you feed birds from your feeder. How you construct these poles, in addition to where you put them, is something that's very important. So I hope that you can use this in your planning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dan Cummings. I'm an attorney with Norman Hansen in Detroit. I'm representing Penny and Joe Parson, who are residents of Avon Road. I'll try to keep my comments brief, as I know there are a lot of people who would like to speak. First thing I want to do is just simply reiterate the state the support for the points that were contained in a letter that was sent by Edward McCall today. To Maureen O'Mara. I'm assuming that the board members will see that. I believe Mr. McCall is here, and he may even comment on those issues. But I think he brings up some very important points as to why the Shore Acres water tower may not work given the proposed amendment and the structure of it, and those two major points being that the location of any antenna on that tower may not be able to go higher than 50 feet on what my understanding is about an 80-foot tower as it exists. And in addition, the lot being so small, there won't be room for some additional expansion there, and it may end up being that the town needs another location in any event, and why, given that, subject the residents of Shore Acres to this intrusion if another area or areas are going to have to be developed for this purpose anyway. And again, I'll let you folks read that letter, or if Mr. McCall is going to address that, he can do it far better than I. In addition to those points, however, I would like to suggest to the board that perhaps some of the stated purposes in the existing ordinance, or at least sort of the governing parameters when analyzing any kind of zoning changes, perhaps weren't giving as much consideration as they should. One of those issues has already been touched upon, and that being the health concerns or potential health concerns of the residents. And I'll comment on that in a minute, and at least a suggestion as to the applicable statute, and maybe that there's suggest perhaps there's a more narrow reading than is necessary. The other is also the impact on values of property. In section 19-10-3, it says the ordinance may be amended by the town council provided the following criteria are met. The first one being that it's consistent with the purpose of the ordinance. It also goes on to say that the planning board must find that the proposal be compatible with the surrounding neighborhood and have no adverse effect on the value of adjacent properties. As far as the stated purpose, as you know, there's a long list of things stated in section 19-1-2. Talks about, the first thing it talks about is that the purpose of the ordinance is to promote the health, safety, and general welfare of the residents of Cape Elizabeth, to encourage the most appropriate use of land throughout the town. It goes on with other things, to also provide safety from fire and other hazards, to promote a wholesome home environment, and to enhance the value of the property within the town. One of the issues that was brought up earlier was the fact that the federal statute prohibits a town from taking into consideration potential adverse health impacts or environmental effects. I'm not so sure, although I haven't done, admit I haven't done any extensive research on this issue, being relatively new to all of this myself in the last few days. But I would agree, I think I concur with Ms. O'Mara, that the purpose of the statute that she quoted is, as she put it, to prohibit the local governmental unit from regulating emission levels. That's for the federal government to do. But I would suggest to the board that that's a different proposition from saying that this body or any municipality in considering amendments to its general comprehensive zoning requirements is not allowed to factor in potential adverse health or environmental effects in deciding where it's going to put a particular or draw out a particular zone that will allow these towers in it. I think those are two different things, and it may very well be worthwhile for the town through its own council to maybe explore that issue a little further. I don't believe that the reading of the statute warrants the reading that probably the industry would like to encourage, and that is you can't consider it at all. The structure of the statute is to allow local bodies to still govern these towers with respect to zoning, and certainly the one of the underlying premises in any zoning law is to promote the health, safety, and welfare of the residents of the state. So it's inconsistent, I think, to say that this provision is to read out of any consideration whatsoever of any health impact. A couple of more points, and then I'll be done, is that I think we would agree with Mr. Emery's statement previously that when stating that he wouldn't suggest that you simply pull out this provision of the plan and then send it along to the council, because as he said, you just don't know enough about what other potential sites there might be. And that is our point exactly, that there may be other areas that aren't so densely populated or that provide more open space that will give a greater buffer zone and still provide coverage. And there ought to be, we think, further inquiry into that area, further discussion, and certainly a little bit broader-based participation by the residents. And the last thing, just so I don't take up too much time, so I'd like to submit kind of an informal petition that went around in the very short period of time, given notice of this hearing, that has somewhere along the lines of 115 signatures of residents of the town of Cape Elizabeth who are in opposition to placing these tower overlay zones in any residential neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth. So for whatever that's worth, I'd like to submit these to the board as well for its consideration and deliberations.
My name is Bob Cronin. I'm a resident of 7 Avon Road, approximately 300 feet from where this communications tower would be located. I've served on the zoning board for 5 years and as the chairman of it once. The zoning board has always tried to prohibit the extension of nonconforming uses in areas where they did not conform. The ordinances of the town do not allow the expansion of a nonconforming use. You could not increase the height of a nonconforming structure. The water tower is in an RB zone, as I look at my zoning map. The maximum height you can put in an RB zone is 35 feet. The water tower is already 80 feet. It was an existing structure, but you cannot expand the use of a nonconforming height. You cannot increase a nonconforming use unless without zoning board approval, factors that you have to take into account is the impact on local land values. Adjacent property owners is the way it takes. Now, the Residence B zone, the purpose of it is stated in the zoning ordinances, if I may read it, the Residence B zone is differentiated from the Residence A district in that subdivisions in the Residence B are required to be laid out according to the principles of open space zoning as described in Section 19.7-2. Open space zoning. The Residence B district includes lands outside the built-up areas of town where a comprehensive plan indicates that growth can and should be accommodated as a result of soil suitable for individual or common septic systems or the extension of public sewer lines. The purpose of this district is to allow a significant portion of the town's anticipated residential growth in these areas in a manner that preserves the character of rural lands, promotes healthy neighborhoods, offers flexibility of design, and minimizes the cost of municipal services. I submit that the introduction of a non-residential use with a height limitations to God knows what in a residential zone is incompatible with that. I would like to echo the last point made that in order to approve a change of zone, the planning board shall to recommend the zone change, the planning board must find the proposal to be compatible with the surrounding neighborhood and have no adverse effects on the value of adjacent properties. Value is created in an auction market. People bidding on if nobody bids on something, it has no value. If a significant number of people do not want to live next to a telecommunications tower, then there are fewer bidders in that market and value is reduced. I submit the zoning ordinances are crystal clear on this. If the introduction of a new zone would hurt or alter adjacent property values, that they are illegal under the terms of the ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I'm asking you as a fellow citizen to respect the rights of those of us in the area and not, unless you can turn a blind eye to the effect on adjacent property values, I'd like you to enforce the ordinances as they are written and give us the protection of them. Thank you.
My name is Skylar Armstrong, and I live on 18 Avon Road, the next lot over from where the tower lot. And I'm concerned about where you're going to put the tower because it's very close to my house, and many of my close friends and neighbors are considering moving if you put this up there, and I don't think they should have to go through the sadness and anger of moving and trying to sell their house and moving their friends. And I think you should think of another place to put the tower. Thank you.
My name is Rachel Bernstein. I live on 1920 Road. I am concerned about the health risks of the telecommunication towers that might go on Shore Acres. I've heard that there's evidence that these towers may cause leukemia or brain damage. I think that these towers should be in a different place than the residential areas or places where lots of people will be often. Thank you.
My name is Jeffrey Monroe. I'm a resident of 11 Katahdin Road in Cape Elizabeth. I've been here there with my family for the last 18 years. In my former life, I was an associate professor of marine transportation and electronics for the State University of New York. And I just wanted to bring up a few points that I thought you would find at least worth considering. First of all, the people and the companies that plan coverage for various areas, particularly with cellular phones, generally plan that coverage to be abundant as opposed to being optimal. Second of all, optimal radiation patterns need to be planned in coverage areas that take into consideration such thing as peak power, emanation, signal attenuation, physical object interference, signal to noise ratios, signal path, and the impact of reflected, refracted, and diffracted RF energy on signal phasing. The most effective way to do these type of patterns, to make them the most effective, is to do them in consistent overlays. And I'll use this room as a very good example of that. You put out a series of lights to try to illuminate the room, and you realize you have dark spots. And how you correct that is you add more lights, right? And that is the same approach that the telecommunications industry takes to coverage on these type of systems. The impact of long-term exposure to microwave radiation has yet to be determined. Studies are inadequate and in many times conflicting. Microwave ovens, radar, other types of transmitters are not deemed risks, but they do incorporate safety features to minimize exposure. Microwave transmissions must be minimized in high-density population areas, and I cannot emphasize that enough. I would submit that most municipal communities do not have the expertise to deal with these type of decisions. Therefore, I would encourage you to engage qualified engineers and consultants to review proposals and optimize coverage through optimal pattern distribution. And before any zoning changes get made, that expertise be brought in to assist. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Sue Garrett, 2 Katahdin Road. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth my entire life. I have two points I would like to raise. I would like the committee to reconsider the regulations of the health issues as previously raised by the attorney. The concern is that the regulations have been strictly interpreted. They should be looked at closely because we may not be able to exclude these towers completely, but the placement and location of these towers are both a legal and ethical obligation of our own community. Secondly, Ms. O'Meara indicated that the committee determined that the industry would rather work with Portland Water District than the state or federal governments. If the industry has so much control and so many regulations for us, why can they choose who they work with? Why can't the community say who the industry can work with? The towers do not belong in any residential neighborhoods.
I'm Edward Robinson. I live in the shadow of the tower on Trundy Road, and Rachel Bernstein's neighbor. I'm a retired physician, therefore have some interest in the health aspect. I did a little research in the Maine Medical Center library the other day, and what little I learned was not reassuring. Electromagnetic fields and the health concerns associated with them remain the most elusive aspects of cellular facility siting. the federal government has adopted no formal standards for what is or is not safe. Another article talked about cataract generation in animals and people. The total findings in one study suggest that microwave exposures are potentially carcinogenic and have other health effects. Therefore, prudent avoidance of unneeded exposure is recommended as a precautionary measure.
Hi, my name is Bob Tripler. I live at 10 Trendy Road. I can see the tower from my front windows, but that's not what I want to talk about, really. I'm not going to address the health concerns. I'm not going to address the property values. Just be repeating what other people have said. But what occurred to me is that somebody pays for the use of these towers, whoever they may be. And I don't understand why the town doesn't use some town property to have these towers located, and that the town derive the income and thereby perhaps even reduce some of our taxes. So I don't like to be so crass about it and talk about money, but it seems to me that it should be a consideration.
My name is Priscilla Armstrong, and I live at 18 Avon Road, and I bought the tower property on two sides. I actually would like to put a very human face on Avon Road. It is a small, dead-end residential road. It has 10 families living on it. It has 12 children under the age of 13. These children go from one house to another, and because it is a dead-end road, that means if you go up, you have to come down the same way. You don't get to go down Spurwink Road two ways. There will be an increase, a significant increase, of traffic going all the way up to the end of the road until you get to my property where it becomes a dirt private access road. This is not appropriate for a residential area. I am concerned about the evaluation of my property, but I am more concerned about what it will do to the nature of our community. We're a very close-knit road. We support each other. We obviously support each other. We're all here. We really do not feel that this is an appropriate manner. I have two other points. The water company, of course, would like to have the towers there. They will get a lot of money. And I have also done some research, and I have found many towns who have thought of that question, and why can't the town reap some benefits if all these towers are coming? And my other point is, one reason why South Portland's range might not be too much is that their ordinance prohibit towers, except for the ones that are currently being challenged in residential areas. Thank you.
Chuck Mainville, 30 Little John Road. We recently moved to Cape Elizabeth from Sudbury, Massachusetts, and I've been involved in this issue